Never in American history have so many presidential primaries been held as are being held in the United States during this election year of 1972. The primaries that have already been held in New Hampshire, Florida, and Illinois have encouraged some candidates and discouraged others. Possibly the most publicized of all the primaries was the one in Florida a couple weeks ago. Hundreds of headlines and thousands of words have been written to interpret what the public was trying to say when Florida gave Governor George Wallace and the idea of an anti-busing amendment victories in the Florida primary election. But strange to say, hardly a line has been written about the proposal concerning putting prayer back in the schools. This proposal got nearly 34,000 more votes than the anti-busing amendment. It got more than twice as many votes as Governor Wallace and President Nixon combined. It was a 4-to-1 margin. The religious editor of the Miami Herald, Don Taft, said, "That ought to say something to somebody up there in Washington." The Miami Herald says, quote, "The present law is interpreted by the Supreme Court does not actually prohibit prayer or Bible reading in the public schools. In fact, in one decision, the court specifically suggested teaching about religion in the classroom. The problem is that lower school officials have used the court's direction that prayer and Bible reading not be prescribed in the sense of a religious service to avoid their responsibility to face up to a difficult situation," end quote from the Miami Herald. There is no doubt that some schools throughout the nation are teaching communism, fascism, republicanism, and democracy. They allow students to organize mock elections, putting one political faction against another. It seems to me that these same students ought to be allowed to freely practice their own faith on campus. Every poll in America among blacks and whites agrees that we ought to have prayer in the public schools. Many leaders say that the Supreme Court has not banned it. If this is true, I would suggest that Christian teachers throughout America start teaching the Bible and having prayer in the schools. Apparently, this is not a violation of the law, as many had thought. Perhaps school officials have misinterpreted the Supreme Court. At any rate, perhaps there ought to be another test case going all the way to the Supreme Court for another ruling and another clarification. Another proposal on a number of state ballots this year will have to do with law. Some say that the law is a killjoy, a deterrent to doing your own thing. Others argue that with human nature being what it is, law and order are needed to bring decorum to a depraved world. When Daniel Webster was Secretary of State under Fillmore, he once dined with 20 gentlemen at the Astor House in New York. The group noticed that Webster, usually an outgoing conversationalist, was withdrawn and quiet. To draw him out, one of the men asked Webster, "Will you tell us what the most important thought is that ever occupied your mind?" Webster replied, "The most important thought that ever crossed my mind was that of my individual responsibility to Almighty God." Webster then talked for 20 minutes on the subject of judgment and then rose from the table and retired to his room. What a world this would be if there were no police, no laws, no courts, no juries, no judges, and no judgment. Since we live in an imperfect world, with human nature being what it is, men must be discouraged in doing evil and encouraged to do good. If sin and passions are permitted to reign unchecked, then chaos and bedlam would rule. First of all, God gave the moral law. He not only gave the law, but the Bible teaches that among God's chief attributes is justice, and that one of his chief roles is that of a judge. His ways are judgment, says Deuteronomy 32. The Lord executeth judgment, said the psalmist in the 103rd Psalm. The Lord is a God of judgment, said Isaiah in the 30th chapter. The judgment of the Lord is according to truth, said Paul in Romans 2. God will bring thee into judgment, said Solomon in Ecclesiastes 11. I've preached in many prisons throughout the world. I've talked to many inmates. Most of these men and women appeared normal in every respect. Most of them were family men and women, and some were even members of the church. I talked to one man who had only committed one crime in his whole life, murder. But how many times must you kill to be a murderer? Only once. Some of you listening to me are saying, God certainly won't judge me. I'm not a bad sinner. I've never committed very many sins. I've just fornicated a little, lied a little, and cheated a little. But how many sins must you commit to be a sinner and come under the judgment of God? The Bible says only one. Secondly, you have broken the law of God. On Mount Sinai, God himself wrote his law upon the tables of stone, and he said, the soul that sinneth shall die. Some ask, what does God have against me that he should judge me? Can you honestly stand up and declare that you have never broken one of his commandments? Can you say that you've never coveted, you've never lied, you've never committed immorality, you've never used God's name in vain, you've never committed idolatry? You certainly cannot, and neither can I. The Bible says we have all sinned. What will be the charges against you at the judgment of God? The charges will be that you have broken God's law, that you have willfully transgressed his moral law. Thirdly, your sins have been fully documented. The Bible says, and the dead were judged out of those things which were written in the books according to their works. God has kept an accurate record of your life. Nothing has escaped his notice. You need not be concerned about an unfair trial, nor need you think that somehow, some way, you might escape the retribution of your Maker. Justice Gray of the Supreme Court once said to a man who had appeared before him in a lower court and had escaped conviction through some technicality, quote, I know you're guilty and you know it, and I wish you to remember that one day you will stand before a better and a wiser judge than I, and there you will be dealt with according to justice and not according to law, end quote. God, being just, will rely upon the written and documented evidence. The Bible says that in that day, he will judge the secrets of men. How would you like your sins to be read aloud right here and now? Suppose I had the record here and were able to read the list of the sins that you've committed. Someday, that is going to happen. Fourthly, many of you have refused to repent. The prophets declared that we should repent. We must repent. Isaiah said, let the wicked forsake his way and the unrighteous man his thoughts, and let him return unto the Lord, for he will abundantly pardon. John preached repentance. Peter preached repentance. Jesus preached repentance. Sometimes in jurisprudence, a condemned man may gain amnesty if he repents of his crime. But many of you have refused to repent of your crime against God, the breaking of God's law. Jonah preached repentance to the city of Nineveh, and God changed his mind about destroying their city. And the Bible says, the men of Nineveh shall rise up in the judgment with this generation and condemn it, because they repented at the preaching of Jonah, and behold, a greater than Jonah is here. You're not dealing with some ancient prophet. You're dealing with a greater than Jonah. You're dealing with the Lord Jesus Christ. And many of you have not repented at the words of Jesus. Fifthly, you have trampled underfoot the blood of Jesus Christ. Jesus died for us and shed his blood for the remission of sins. And by failure to repent of your sins, you have made the blood of Christ of no effect as far as you are concerned. The Bible states that this is a serious offense. How much sore a punishment, suppose ye, shall be thought worthy who hath trodden underfoot the Son of God. God has done everything he can to save you. He has asked you to repent, and you have stubbornly resisted and rebelled. He has offered the sacrifice of his Son, and you've rejected and ignored him. He has exhorted you to live above sin, and you have not. You leave God no alternative but to judge you. Sixthly, you will be at the judgment. The Bible describes the last judgment in graphic and dramatic terms. I saw a great white throne, and him that sat upon it, from whose face the heaven and the earth fled away. And there was found no place for them. And I saw the dead, small and great, stand before God, and the books were opened. And another book, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged out of those things which are written in the books. Jesus said, Marvel not at this, for the hour is coming in the which all that are in the grave shall hear his voice and shall come forth. They that have done good unto the resurrection of life, and they that have done evil unto the resurrection of damnation. Paul said, He hath appointed a day in which he will judge the world in righteousness by that man whom he hath ordained, whereof he hath given assurance unto all men, in that he hath raised him from the dead. Yes, you will be at the judgment. Human beings, 130,000 a day, 60 million a year, are marching into eternity. Not into the unknown, but before a just God, either unto life of life or death of death. Which way are you going? Which road are you on? Are you one of the 60,000 that will die today and go into eternity? Seventhly, how will you plead on that great day? Will you plead innocent? Will you dare to say that you've never sinned? The Bible declares that our own righteousness is as filthy rags. The Bible says there's none righteous, no, not one. Or will you plead ignorance? Will you say that you've never heard? Will you say that you don't know about God's plan of salvation? With the radio carrying gospel programs, the gospel on television, a church on almost every corner in America, as the Bible says, they are without excuse. The Bible says you are without excuse. Or will you plead that you've been religious? Jesus said to the Pharisees, who had a form of godliness but denied the power thereof, Verily I say unto you that the publicans and the harlots shall go into the kingdom of God before you. Or will you say that you didn't have enough time? Over and over again, the Bible presses upon us the urgency of deciding for Christ now. This is a now gospel. The Bible says now is the accepted time. Today is the day of salvation. God is under no obligation to give you another chance after today. You are having a chance at this moment by listening to this broadcast. Eighthly, there will be a verdict. In every trial, there are three elements: the charge, the evidence, and the verdict. The charge is that you have sinned and that your name is not found in the book of life. The evidence is written in the record, and the verdict is sure. And whosoever was not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. I wish we would sing that old hymn more often. Is my name written there? I remember hearing it when I was a young man many times. Lord, I care not for riches, neither silver or gold. I would make sure of heaven. I would enter the fold. In the book of thy kingdom with its pages so fair, tell me, Jesus, my Savior, is my name written there? That makes more sense than a lot of other questions we ask, like, is my name in Who's Who? Is my name in Dun and Bradstreet? Is my name on the social register? Or even is my name on the church roll? It is eternally important to know that your name is written in God's book. Will the verdict be, I never knew you? Or will it be, enter into the joy of the Lord? How can you be sure? The answer echoes through the Old and the New Testaments. Isaiah said, All we like sheep have gone astray, but the Lord hath laid on him the iniquity of us all. Paul said, In whom we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins according to the richness of his grace. John wrote about that joyful, happy throng in the Revelation. And they sang a new song, saying, Thou art worthy to take the book and to open the seals thereof. For thou wast slain and hast redeemed us to God by thy blood out of every kindred and tongue and people and nation. When I stand at the gate of heaven, I'm going to throw myself on the mercy of the court. I'm going to cling to the cross. My only reason for being in heaven will be the grace of God and the cross of Jesus Christ. It's said that in the Philadelphia Mint, there's a pair of scales so sensitive that if a piece of paper is put on the tray and the scales balanced, then the piece of paper removed and a name written thereon with a pencil, that the added weight of the writing will send the tray down. Your name written on the pages of the eternal record may send the tray on the scales down, but if you write the name of Jesus on the other side, the scales will go down on the other side. His grace is greater than my sin. His mercy is greater than my iniquities. And there's one thing invisible to God, and that is my sins when they were under the blood of Christ that he shed on that first Good Friday 1972 years ago. Shall we pray? Our Father and our God, we thank thee for the grace of God. When all is said and done, only one thing counts, and that is Jesus Christ on that cross, dying for us and raised again for our justification. We pray that during this coming week that all over the world, thousands of people will stop, look, and listen concerning eternity and repent of their sins and turn by faith to Jesus Christ. For we ask it in his name. Amen.